Subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
National interest this week goes into an intriguing and complex political territory. Why is it so that Narendra Modi keeps winning despite everything his opponents throw at him? What is it that the opponents are getting wrong? Can they find another way so they can do better, particularly when they come up head to head against Narendra Modi and his BJP directly? Does the latest Pew survey on India's religious attitudes throw any light on this and give us some lessons? We think it does. And we will count those lessons for you. And we will also tell you that some of these lessons actually come from the contradictions that this survey throws up. But before I go there, this is my time once a month to remind you of your contribution, that you have to take a paid subscription to The Print. That is the only way we can keep going. Independent media, particularly if it is unhyphenated like us. When you're hyphenated, one side or the other will look after you. But independent media with wide-ranging coverage and opinion, with reporters going all across the country all the time, needs readers to pay for it. You pay for your newspaper every day, you pay for your magazines, you pay for your OTT channels, you pay for your cable TV. Please pay for your news. Because if you do not pay for the news, then you know that you are being had one way or the other. Because anything that comes for free, particularly anything of intellectual value or which has intellectual inputs, if that comes to you for free, it's got to have a problem with it, because it will be loaded with something. So please contribute. If you already are contributing, then top up your monthly contribution. If you are not, then please take a subscription. I promise you, we'll use it in the best way possible and we'll make you proud of The Print. Now, all of you know about the latest Pew research on Indians and their religious attitudes. It's been in the headlines, it's been debated to death on our TV channels, it's been written about by columnists. So what is it that I'm taking about? Main kya isme se nayi goti nikal ke laya hu? What new thing that I have found in this? So I look at everything in terms of politics. A lot of the debate on this survey so far has been sociological. Oh, Indians love fellow Indians, even if they are of other origins, but they don't want them as neighbors. That Indians love fellow Indians of other religions, but they don't want to marry with them. Those are all sociological things. What are the political lessons that we learn from this? So here are some key questions. How do you win an election in India? More specifically, what do you tell the voter and in which language that they buy into your message and your electoral proposition? Because so far it's not happening with the opposition. Narendra Modi and his BJP know the answers and they will not tell the opposition. But they know the answers. That's why they keep winning. They have a track record now. So the questions, these questions are not for them. These are for all the others who've been racking their brains and banging their heads against the titanium wall of Narendra Modi's electoral proposition, unable to break it or unable to scale it. They also know that it is possible to defeat the BJP if Narendra Modi is not on the ticket, as they have seen in many states, most significantly recently in West Bengal, where Narendra Modi threw so much of his political capital and effort in that campaign. It was very different, for example, from the campaign in Delhi, where Arvind Kejriwal defeated the BJP just months after the general election, because that was not riding on Narendra Modi's reputation and name as much as West Bengal was. So it is possible to defeat the BJP when Modi is not on the ticket. But the important thing is, how do you win elections to the center? Because that is the big prize in India. Winning one state, two states, three states counts for nothing, because the center is where the power is. And whoever controls the center then also has a lot of power over the states. So if you're an aspirant from the opposition, you would ask with good reason, just why does Modi's vote percentages keep rising? Why people aren't listening to me? Does secularism mean nothing to them? Has my country changed so radically in the past 7 years? All our people have become bigoted. They don't want to vote for quote-unquote secular parties. How come even the pull of caste fails now? You want to know what I'm talking about? I'm talking about how the SP-BSP alliance in UP in 2019, usually that should have swept the election, because if we just added the arithmetic, that did not work. That actually bombed. Why did that happen? Similarly, if people are so brainwashed that it is so impossible to make them understand something else, what can I do? They will keep on voting for Narendra Modi. But you know, politics is dynamic. Politics never stops. Politics is an ongoing business. Actually, one reason Narendra Modi, Amit Shah and the BJP are so successful at it is that they don't sit back on their haunches. They don't think politics is now frozen, that they can continue winning. They keep working at it, and so does the opposition need to do. And one of the places where they can look for some lessons is the findings of this survey. Now, people of India, we know, are busy. They don't have any time listening to all comers to decipher their words, their intentions, read their minds, particularly if they don't look them in the eye also. You have to give them the message they want to hear. You can also make them want to hear that message, but you can only do it if you talk to them in the language they understand and they also respect. At the same time, where they feel respected. So don't say, don't you know it's a cheap thing to vote for the BJP? Vote for me. They will not buy into that. That is what I mean. You know, just by counting Modi's flaws, you cannot impress them and win an election. You have to give them an alternative proposition. That's what Yogendra Yadav said in his article for us the other day. He said, what you need is not Vipaksh, but Pratipaksh. Vipaksh is opposition. Pratipaksh is alternative. So how do you produce an alternative? That is the language that you need to discover and then package the message accordingly. Now, what should that language be? We find many answers in the data from this Pew survey as we search beyond the headline points. Many of these answers, in fact, lie in the contradictions it throws up, as I told you earlier. And please perish the lazy argument that this is just a survey of 30,000 people. Surveys that have robust methodologies do not need millions of people. Then you might as well hold a referendum. And also, Sanjay Kumar of Lokniti CSDS tells us in a couple of tweets that he put out, and you will see them on the screen, that these survey results pretty much reflect what the Lokniti CSDS survey had found in 2015 on religious attitudes. So also, you can't say that 7 years of Modi have transformed the Indian mind. India has now become a communally bigoted country. It was always a secular country. India is as it was. Just that one side knows how to give out a political message and in which language, and the other doesn't. Now let's look at the contradictions. Five contradictions that this survey throws up. And listen to me carefully, because each point has the contradiction built in. First, almost all Indians are deeply religious but equally tolerant of all other faiths. Contradiction: deeply religious but equally tolerant of all other faiths. Second, they see religion as the central pillar of their identity. I am who I am because I am a Hindu, Muslim, Christian, Jain, Buddhist, Sikh. They see religion as a central pillar of their identity, but do not expect that it also defines the nationalism of others. That's a subtle point. Because if you follow, say, Hindu nationalism, someone else does not have to follow Hindu nationalism. Your nationalism is your nationalism. Your nationalism is not defined in religious terms. Then you will see somebody of another faith as less of an Indian. That is not the feeling at all. Third, they believe that it's the essential calling of their faith and the responsibility of their nationalism to respect followers of other faiths. Good point. Yet, and this is the contradiction, yet one third of them do not want a neighbor from another religion. Fourth, 97% of Indians who vote for the left, communists, believe in God. What does it mean? Contradiction? And fifth, while they love their fellow citizens of other faiths, adore India's diversity and share equally the feeling of patriotism, they mostly don't want anybody from amongst them marrying outside their flock. This aversion to marrying outside extends strongly to caste as well. People define kinship in India in their own way. So here are five contradictions. So here are five political takeaways from these data points. One, Indians are deeply secular, not in spite of their religiosity, but because of it. Why do we say so? Because they say, my religion tells me to respect other religions. So Indians are deeply secular, not in spite of their religiosity, but because of it. Second, they do not believe the canard that somehow people of another faith or of a particular faith are not loyal to the country. Nobody seems to buy it, because if they were, they won't respect them. Third, I'd prefer my neighbor to be from my faith, because stretching from culture, rituals, festivals, to most importantly, food, it gives me a sense of community. It is instructive that the community most averse to a neighbor from another faith are the Jains, that is 92%. Also because they have particularly strong, distinctive vegetarian choices. So food's very important. Fourth, I may vote for the left, but I have no time for their godless ideology. So I may vote for the left for various reasons. Maybe I like a left leader very much. I like Pinarayi Vijayan very much, but it doesn't mean that I am a communist in the classical sense. That's very important. This is why the left is shrinking in India instead of growing, despite deep inequalities in our society. And last, of course, I love a fellow Indian of any faith, but intermarrying is going too far. What does it mean? To sum it all up, it means I adore my country's diversity. I'm proud of it, but I like my own diverse identity as well. So I'd rather protect it. Don't toss me into a homogenizer with others. Don't toss me up in a homogenizer with others. Unity is not uniformity. Anybody who pushes it will provoke my hypersensitive immune system, and either I will break out into rashes, or I'll make you break out into rashes. How does Narendra Modi's BJP get around it? They appeal sharply and unhesitatingly to the Hindu-Indian identity. They've already discounted the minority, especially the Muslims, because they say they won't ever vote for us. As you see, so dear Hindus, more and more of you should vote for us. Would you do so? Or would you rather give over the veto over who rules India to a smaller minority that doesn't vote for us? It is a language the voters understand. Don't judge voters. As is said in marketing, the customer is always right. The consumer is always right. The voter is the consumer of your message, your product in this case. They understand. In most states, if the BJP wins more than 50% of Hindu votes, they are home. In a state like West Bengal, they needed about 60-65, and that's why they failed. So this is how their formula works. It follows that because Muslims mostly vote against the BJP, it is painted as a vote against the Hindus. 81 versus 15% is actually game, set and match before the ball is even served. You know, you might have noticed that I have gone away from cricketing metaphors right now. Wimbledon is on right now, so tennis. Barring in states where other determinants of identity are more dominant, Tamil Nadu is a good example. So there are always exceptions that prove the rule. There is reason why people are not listening to Modi's rivals. Because they are speaking a language people neither like nor understand. You lecture them on secularism, people wonder if you are suggesting they are bigoted. Just because I vote for BJP, am I bigoted? Just because I vote for Narendra Modi, am I bigoted? So don't make them feel guilty. Make them feel proud. You promise them socialism, but so does everybody else. Indian politics has invented the largest number of variants of socialism, and nobody has as yet invented a vaccine for them. You attack Modi for economic performance, and the answer is a voter doesn't live by roti dal or dal bhat alone. Over the decades, in the confusion of agnostic, rational, inherited Nehruvian secularism, drummed into the heads of generations by intellectuals of the left, Congress and many other parties, especially in the heartland, have ceded religion to the BJP. India will never be secular because people put their religious identity aside. India will remain secular because it is deeply religious and its people have internalized poet Iqbal's message. Mazhab nahi sikhata apas mein bair rakhna. Religion doesn't teach us to hate each other. You irritate me, on the other hand, when you sermonize me. Take my secularism for granted, or I see it as a dog whistle to the minorities, read Muslims, to vote for you. In which case, I know where I am going to vote. This confusion between who's a Hindu voter and who is secular one is one of the main reasons why Modi's rivals have failed to mount a credible challenge to him, because they divide the voter as secular and communal based on who they vote for, and you know where they end up. If the BJP wins by getting Hindu votes to consolidate, its opponents can't beat it by bundling together the Muslims with some of the others, which can be specific castes, say Yadavs in some cases, say Dalits in some cases. A credible challenger, on the other hand, would need to bring Hindus and Muslims together, because that will be a counter to the BJP. A credible challenger would need to bring Hindus and Muslims together while they live in their own respective skins, neighborhoods, and kinships. That's the political idiom and language the findings of the surveys commend. On which note, I shall conclude this. And once again, I will remind you of my call to take a paid subscription, because good readers, good citizens, good viewers pay for their news and opinion.